Alright, we're back with this 99. Earlier today, I was chatting with my good friend Patty down in Florida. And while we're talking on the phone, I was just aimlessly starting to put this machine together. And I realized, oh crap, I'm supposed to be doing this on camera. So, I will confess, I had the stitch length regulator mechanism and everything back in. I'm going to leave the feed dog rock shaft in. That's two screws. I think you guys know how to put one of these back in place. It's not adjusted anyway. The only thing I did was make sure that there's... Well, actually, I didn't even do that. This has got some way too much end play on it at this point. So, yeah, just... It's in. It's two screws. It's not adjusted. So, first thing we're going to do... We're going to take the fork for the stitch length regulator. I'm just going to wipe this down. This has got a little too much oil on it. Everything, as you can see, has been cleaned. Last episode, we went through on some different techniques. I'm just going to put the arm... Actually, I'll drop the bolt in. I won't put the nut on just yet. I'm just going to put the bolt in there a little bit, and I have the adjusting screw going into the machine here. I'm going to take a magnet on the stick and the regulator. I'm going to pop that through the hole here, and I'm going to have to use a screwdriver. And I've got the okay, let me show you the little nubby here on the regulator. Let me get some of that excess crud off. Well, not crud, it's oil. Lubricating oil. A little bit much. Alright, I'm going to put the magnet right there. You see the portion of the regulator I'm putting it on. I'm going to put it in the hole. And I'm getting that basically... Oops, stay put. I'm going to get it down there pretty much... retract a little bit. I'm going to get it pretty much into position. And, alright, let me show you another thing. I want the bearing on the fork to be kind of over and up a little bit. So I'm going to have to manually move this around. But I'm turning the main shaft so that this portion of the rock shaft is as far towards this back end of the machine as it'll go. Because that'll get things really, get the fork more where I want it. Now... I might have to pull this, push and pull on that to get, as I'm pushing through here, I'm going to pivot using my screwdriver to get that over and scooch that on. If I can get this to cooperate. Yep, there it goes. And now I'm just going to kind of scooch it on there, and I'm sliding that onto the bearing, magnet out of the way. Scooching that over. Might have to screw that in a little bit more. There we go. I've got it in, and now I can line up, I can look down the hole, and I can line up the threaded part in there. I hope that made sense. Let me try zooming in a little bit. I'm hoping talking you through that is helping. And I'm going to hold that a little, actually get that a little bit better lined up. There. If you look down, I don't know how well you can see. I just knocked it a little out of alignment, but I'm going to move it with the screwdriver here. You can see there, it's a little out. I can't do that and hit it at an angle. But you can imagine that looking down the hole, you can pretty much center up. You move the rock shaft. Here, let me zoom wider again. If you move the rock shaft down here, you can alter that positioning. And once you've done all that, you've got that pretty well lined up. You take your washer, your lock washer, it has the three prongs. You want the three prongs facing the body of the machine. And you can drop your pivot bolt on in there. And then go ahead and screw it on down. And you can go ahead and crank the, well, I don't have to crank it super tight, just get her nice and firm. And I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to put the balance wheel on for just a second here. get that screw backed out. I have not cleaned and polished that yet. I'm just going to put it on just to test. Okay, that's moving real nice. And I can just sit here with the pitman arm and make that spin real nice. So, okay, that's going to be good. I'm going to go ahead and take that off. All right, we're going to worry about the adjustment of the feed dog rock shaft. The lateral play, because we got to worry about the position of the feed dog and the needle plate and everything yet. That's still coming up. So I'm just going to go ahead. I'm going to get this nut started. And I'll do a little bit more than just get it started. I'll just get that on there. Like I said, the adjustments that we're going to be dealing with for the feed dogs, we're looking at the three points here for the adjustment. The pivot screw up on this end, the pivot screw down below, of course, which is more towards the nose of the machine. That is the lateral, those pivot screws and their lock nuts adjust the position. Let me pull the needle plate out and a feed dog. Okay, needle plate's not finished yet. But these pivot points adjust the side-to-side position of the feed dog in the needle plate. Actually, it would help to hold it correctly. So, the lateral position. And this eccentric screw here, with its nut, that adjusts the fore and aft position this way in the needle plate. So we'll be making those adjustments as we go along. We're just not going to do it right this second. Okay, we've got that in. Next, once again, I'm doing this without my nice fancy fixture that I use to hold sewing machines. Said I'm going to do this one as simple as possible so people who don't have that kind of hardware can follow along. Next piece that has to go in, we have to connect this rod. This connecting rod has to be attached to the bell crank. On the bell crank end, it has to happen before it goes into the machine. If it's not on before it goes into the machine, it is not going to work. Let me readjust the camera, bring it down a little bit lower, and we'll see what we got going here. Okay, to start off, we need to attach this connecting rod to the bottom of the bell crank. So we want this set up so that these adjusting screws are going to be towards the back end of the machine. So flipping that over here, so I know it's going to be right, and I'm putting the bolt in, and I know it's the correct bolt because you'll see it's a shoulder bolt. When I put it through, it's just like a thou or so proud of the bottom end of this connecting rod, so we know it's the correct one. That's something, as the more of these you do, you'll be able to see it and say, oh yeah, that's the right one. You'll be able to just pick it out just by sight. Find the screwdriver I want. Here we go. Alright, so we get that in. We get that snug. Now, I'm not messing with those screw adjustments there. And I have the barrel bolt that's going to, the bell crank's going to pivot on, setting that in position. Next piece that's going to go in, however, is going to be the lifter. I'm going to get the lifter here handy like that, and oops, get pointed in the right direction. Once again, it's on a shoulder bolt. When we go through, it's within a thou or so, maybe two thou, proud of the back. That is going to go into position. And we'll start the screw and get her in. Here comes the fun part. We've got our barrel bolt. We're going to slide the lifter into the cam on the bell crank. And then we're going to slip this end into the pitman arm. I'm going to get this screw started. You got to do it this way. You got to get these things pretty much on. You don't want to bend this rod. If you don't do it this way, you'll wind up bending the rod. Okay, that's on. And now we'll get that screw started. Love these screw starters. They're really great. Okay. Now, if we... Oh, look at that. Nice freed motion. Everything's great. Now, what I like to do, I know a lot of my contemporaries don't do it this way, and but I do. What I like to set up the, do the adjustments for the feed dog rock shaft and for the stitch length regulator to get the feed dog completely adjusted in the needle plate even before we worry about doing putting the hook in and doing the timing. I like to do this now for a couple reasons, not the least of which is it's nice not to have all that other crap around to get in your way. So I'm just going to go ahead and I'm going to slip the feed dog. Now, I'm going to put this feed, I'm going to stand the machine up a little bit. I'm going to slip the feed dog into the arm on the rock shaft. And I'm just going to drop the screw in. Actually, you know what? Strike that. I'm going to use a screw starter. There we go. Got that in there. So now I can get that up. Get that down. And I'm going to put the feed dog at about the midway position for height-wise. I'm not worried about feed dog height yet because this is going to come out again after we make these initial adjustments. I'm doing these adjustments now because it's a lot easier to do it before you have all the other crap in the way. Crap being the operative word. All right. Like I said, I have not polished this yet. Not cleaned, not polished. Alrighty, let me pull the screws. Here's one. Get that going. It's also a lot easier to do this when you don't have the stitch length, you don't have the upper thread tension mechanism in your way, you don't have the lifter arm in your way. I like to call this the life is good, life is easy portion of the assembly. Get all this done when there's no other crap, and it makes it easy to get these screws in and out, easy to see what the heck you're doing. And I think I've shown me this way of doing it before, and if I haven't, sorry. All right, first thing I do, I run the stitch length all the way in, and we're going to look first at feed dog position. Now, sometimes it helps to take another light source. That's why these things are great. Put it up down below and shine some light up from down below so you can see what you're doing. You can see any light coming in through the needle plate. Let me get this in up in here. I can. You're not going to be able to see it, but I will be able to. So, well, I can see right now that the feed dog's adjustment is it's all the way over in this direction. I got to bring it back here some. So I'm just going to move the rock shaft a little bit. If there's enough space to move the rock shaft. No, I don't have enough adjustment in there. It's not sloppy enough for that. So, all right. What we're going to do, I'm going to lay her on her side. I'm going to grab my 9/16 wrench. Actually, I don't even have to grab the wrench just yet. Those are pretty loose yet. But I'm going to back this screw off. I'm holding this. I'm going to back this screw off. I'm just going to move this finger tight. And I'm going to loosen this. This I will need the wrench for on this end. I'm going to loosen the opposite side. And I'm just going to run that screw down a little bit. Not worrying about the nut just yet. All right. Now, that is too tight. So I'm going to back that off just a skosh. And now turn it through. All right, that feels good, but let's see what the adjustment looks like. All right, I need to move it this way towards me just a little bit more. So I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to back that screw up about a quarter of a turn. And then run that an equal amount. How's it feel? Still feels good. Let's see what it looks like. And that looks good. The feed dog looks like it's centered pretty well laterally in the needle plate. I know you can't see it right now. You're going to have to take my word for that. So what I'm going to do, while I've got it like this, and I know the lateral adjustment is correct, I'm going to take my 9/16 box wrench, put it around my screwdriver. I'm going to hold the screwdriver firm, and I'm going to tighten that jam nut. I'm going to flip the machine over, hold it up once again on my block of wood. I'm going to lather, rinse, repeat on this side. And I'm going to tighten that as well. There's ever so slightly an amount of, it's more of a feel than an actual movement. That's good. I like that. I like the adjustment to feel like that. Now, put her back up. I'm going to hold this end up, and it feels nice when I'm spinning it. So I'm holding this end up because the pivot point of the bell crank is on the table. I want to get that off the table. And that feels great. Now, I'm looking at the feed dog and stitch length maximum. As I'm walking it through, it looks like it's coming close, not quite, but close to hitting in the back. So I'm going to move that just a skosh. All right, that's the back end portion. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to get my 3/8 wrench once again. All right, now I had kind of tightened that up a little bit, so I'm going to loosen that just a little bit. And now, because I know the position that that's in, I'm going to look around on this side, and I'm going to move that just a little bit. Hold it in that position. Oops, wrong side. Tighten her back up. And I'm going to turn it once again. And it's in no danger of hitting anything anymore. Fantastic. I do not need those anymore. I'm going to unscrew the feed dog. Get that out of the machine because it is officially in the way for reassembling everything else that's going to be going on inside the needle bar area. But I got to get this plate off first. And Bob, don't be an idiot, as Bob just was. I disconnected the feed dog without taking the plate off and expected to be able to pull it out. Hey, what can I say? It's almost 10:30 and I've been moving all day. So, all right, long old screwdriver. We'll pull these out, and we won't see this needle plate again for a little while. I'm going to make a confession to you guys. I know we've been calling this series a 99 for Sandra, but Sandra's not getting this machine. I spoke with her the other day, and she's like, Bob, I kind of need reverse. Do you have a 99 with reverse? And I'm like, I certainly do, because I recently got one. So what I did was, this morning, early, I did a full service on a much later 99, one from the 1950s, and got it running perfectly for her. And today that shipped. So hopefully in a couple of days she will have it. If United Parcel Service is good on their promises of delivery date anyway. I'm going to use a bottle brush and just scrub that out a little bit. See if that feels any better. It does not. Okay. So, how do we fix that? That feels a little tight. So, I thought I had cleaned that sufficiently. Apparently, I failed. So, what do we do? We're going to polish it out right now. Yeah, that'll fit. And cylindrical hard felt. And I'm just gonna go through there and polish that surface out. Make sure I go all the way down. I have to do this completely from the bottom. I just cannot access that from the top. Well, actually, I probably can with my flexible shaft tool. And now I have a variable speed unit for it. I'll be using that a lot more. You'll be seeing it. You'll be seeing it soon. I've got an older Dremel. It's a model 732. Well, that was smart. 732 flexible shaft tool that I've had, oh gosh, I want to say 25, 30 years, something like that. And I've used it a bit. I don't think I've ever used it really in the videos here. But it's just a single speed, and it's kind of a bit of a pain. But it does use, I can use Fordham hand pieces on it, which is nice. Dremel doesn't make that particular one anymore. But it's a real nice unit. But like I said, it's single speed. And that can be problems with a lot of the bits. But I've got this router speed control from Harbor Freight that if you switch it on that direction, it gives you full power. Switch it that way, it's variable speed, and then you got a speed dial, and it works really, really well. I was messing with it the other day, actually, when I was cleaning these parts after I did the last video where I demonstrated the techniques I was going to be using. I cleaned a lot of parts using it. I was very, very happy with it. All right, let's see if that improved. Much better. Much better, but I'm not super happy yet. So let's find out why I'm not super happy. All right. I'm going to take this hook shaft here, and I'm going to polish that just a little bit more. All right, now I know that I did most of the cleaning on this with normal tools. But I took that to the buffing wheel because, honestly, at this point, I just want to get this machine back together and ready to do something with. It just doesn't feel as smooth as I would like. I'm going to take one more pass with the rotary tool and do a little bit more polishing. Some paper towel down below, grab a cotton swab, get some oil on the cotton swab and wipe around in here to make sure we got all the buffing dirt out. Just swab that out. I think I got most of it. Go through. Okay. Into a dry one now just to make sure we got the majority of the schmoo out of there. I think that's pretty well polished out now. There was a lot of dried oil on a lot of these parts. Ah, that feels better already. Okay. We're going to call that good. All right. Now that will be, that's at the lowest point of its travel right there. Swing this around. Actually, yeah, that's good. And let's get the linkages in place. Find the screw for the linkage, which is right here. And we need the end linkage, which is right here. Okay. That's going to go on. Come on. Yeah, there we go. Now it's going in. Okay. Now, swing her around. I've got the linkage here all the way, the link on the cam, all the way at the bottom. And I'm going to rotate the hook so it's pretty much, that's going to be pretty close to time. Just from experience, I know it's going to be pretty close to time. I'm going to go ahead and get the screw going here. That's going to be close. It's not going to be precise, but it's going to be close. It's either going to be very close or it's going to be 180 degrees out. I think that's going to be close. Okay. Snugged, but not tight. All right. Let's run her. That looks good. Let's really run her. Let's put the balance wheel back on and give her a spin and watch the mechanism run. That'll be just fine. That's going to be real nice. Keep in mind I haven't oiled anything. I haven't adjusted the lash on that, although that feels good. I'm going to adjust that lash right now. That's good. And going through this hole. I must not have moved that one because that one's perfect. Yep. All right. So there we are. We got the bottom end done. The bottom end is in, I should say. I'm not going to put the bobbin case positioning bracket nor the bobbin case in. A couple reasons. Number one, I haven't cleaned the bobbin case positioning bracket or the bobbin case yet. But I also don't want it in the way when we go to time this puppy. So let's start at the top end. Shall we? You know, from the earliest days of this channel, I have been doing these videos, and to borrow a line from the movie Command Decision, I've been giving it to you with the bark on. Whenever I make a mistake, you see it. Well, I had taken a little breather. And I walked away and I came back and I completely reassembled the nose of this machine. And then I realized, oh crap, I wasn't rolling.
So I'm like, okay, well, I just took it all apart again. But what I did not take out was the pin for the transfer fork and the transfer fork and the lifter lever, simply because removing these, they have, in my opinion, they have a limited number of insertions and removals. Now, I will go back to what I was talking, well, now what I was talking to myself about, because I thought I was talking to you guys. When I did the disassembly, I had commented that I believed that there was a stripped, or excuse me, a broken screw here. It, in fact, is not a broken screw. That is a pin that is protruding that is also the pin for the pivot for the transfer fork inside for the upper thread tension assembly. And that pin, now, this is a dirty plate yet, I haven't cleaned it, that pin will stick out into that hole, so it will go on thusly, and the pin protrudes here, and then you simply tighten the screw. It's a little different than what we're used to. Normally we have a thumb screw there. It's slightly different. This is, once again, is a much older machine. And as I've mentioned before, you know, there are some things that are different with this one that have been, there was different improvement models made in the 99. Now, also what I had done was I had put the needle plate back on for the purposes of adjusting the presser bar. I'm not taking that off at this point. I'm going to leave it in place. You can pretend that we're going to put it back on later when it comes time to adjust the needle plate. But let's get going again. And for the second time tonight, I'm going to reassemble this machine. And we're going to start with the connecting rod and the offset pin. Now, on the offset pin, which I'm not really even sure if that's the official name that Singer has for it, you have the main shaft of the pin with a ground area, a ground flat, where the set screw from the cam goes, and the pin itself is offset with the pivot point for the thread take up. Conveniently, the ground flat is in line with the offset arm, so just lining that up and sticking it into the machine, it's relatively easy. It's a simple operation, really, to line this up and get the set screw into the appropriate portion of the offset pin. Now I'm going to put that just slightly and watch the pin move as I tighten the set screw. You see how that just tight, that moved a little bit? All right, now I'm going to push that back just a little bit, lightly pushing it back, because what I want when this is on and snug, I want the connecting rod to be able to move freely, but I don't want fore and aft motion of it like that. So that's perfect. That's just fine. Next piece that's going to go in is going to be the thread take-up assembly. And I'm going to go ahead and swing this on down a little bit to make it a little bit easier to do. I'm going to pre-position the pivot bolt screw that goes up on top onto a screw starter. Start by putting that portion on the linkage there. I'm going to manually just kind of skosh that up and then take my screw and stick it in. I knew that these things were going to make it a lot easier for me to show you guys what I'm doing. All right, we'll run that in. Okay, it's set, but it's not tight. Now it's tight. And let's just for a real quick test. See that we can't do a real quick test like that. All right, no worries. Next, we're going to drop in the needle bar. The needle bar, of course, has the area ground where the needle goes. That's going to go towards this end of the machine. And by the way, yeah, another thing I put in when I thought camera was running before was the spring that holds the bobbin slide plate cover in, and I'm not taking it off again. Sorry. It's one screw and a spring. So I'm dropping that in. Bada bing, bada boom. Putting it down pretty much all the way. I'm going to bring this up a little bit. I'm going to, out of my bag of tricks, grab the needle clamp and then scooch the needle up into the needle clamp, bring it around so that the groove is towards the outside, bring it back down. Lower connecting rod is completely vertical. Now I'm going to have this so it's just proud of the top of the needle clamp. It's not correct adjustment. It's just where it's going to be at the moment, where I know it will hit the flat on the needle bar. And I get my screwdriver in the back, if I can find the slot. Come on, get on. There we go. It's in it now. And I'm just going to tighten that up just a little bit. Not super tight because it's not an adjustment. And oh, look at that. It moves like I knew it was going to because I've already done this. Anyway, am I mad at myself? No. Am I laughing at myself? No. Because it's now 6 minutes after 11 on Friday night, and I did this a long time ago. All right, we're going to put the pressure bar back in. And this is why the needle plate was already on the machine. I'm going to help that presser bar get down a little bit. I'm going to take a punch and just kind of line her up and give her a tappy tap tap from above. There it goes. It got on through. It's going to come down. And the presser foot is by no means clean, but I'm going to put the presser foot on the machine anyway, temporarily, because we're going to make this adjustment but once. So, we have the lifter bars all the way down, the sliding block is down. Now, on the presser foot, will be adjusted when we take the slack thread regulator, we get that in position. Let me grab my smaller, this long screw, it's the one that actually closes up the clamp that holds the sliding block onto the needle bar, the presser bar, as well as holding the slack thread regulator in place. Not tightening, just getting it to its bottomed out, but not tight. This smaller screw goes on the other side, keeps it level. Once again, not tightening. Now, I'm going to look down. We have the slot here in the presser foot. I'm going to center the hole in the needle plate in that slot. Make sure these bars are down. This is so much easier to do now because we don't have a feed dog in there that we have to position. And we're going to tighten this up. Bada bing, bada boom. And that's good. We can actually, we'll leave that on for the moment. You notice I did not put this thread guide in yet, nor did I put the thread cutter on yet. That will happen shortly. We're going to go ahead. I'm putting the adjuster screw back in on top. And let's see what we got. Yay, it works. All right, let's get this off. Get that out of the way. All right, last but not least, we have the opposite thread screw that holds the rest of that linkage together. That's a lefty tighty, righty loosey. You thought I was going to forget that, didn't you? I can see the comments already. Bob, you screwed up. There it is. There we go. And it's nice and pretty. We will be making adjustments to the needle bar height, as well as down below doing timing adjustments. We'll take the needle plate off for that. As I believe I have mentioned in the past, the needle bar on this machine is not the usual 250 thousandths of an inch in diameter. This one is 187 thousandths, which means that I cannot use a needle bar clamp that's already marked as I can. I can, like, for example, on a 66, I can take a marked needle bar clamp out of a 201, for instance. Or I can also modify needle bar clamps. This one I'm not going to modify because it actually has the part number engraved in on it. So this is the setup I'm going to use to check and adjust the timing. I have a 6-inch steel rule and a button magnet. Now, let me zoom in and I'll show you how that is set up. With the bottom linkage for the needle bar at its full lowest position, meaning the needle bar itself is all the way down at its lowest position, I've positioned the steel rule so that in this case, the number 3, the 3-inch mark, is even with the bottom of the needle bar clamp. Now, I do have the pressure bar raised here so we can see this easier. Now, if I turn the balance wheel in the direction of normal operation and raise the needle bar 3/32 of an inch to that position there, as you can see, now it is opposite 3/32 of an inch higher. That is the correct position to, number 1, check timing, and number 2, check needle bar height. It's a little off, so let me get this back down on her nose or on her feet and just make a minor adjustment. But I think we got the timing set. Actually, now that I've got it down on the ground, it's dead nuts on. I'm going to leave that alone. We'll see how close I am. But in the meantime, let me check the needle bar height. My needle bar height's just a little low, so I'm going to bring that up. Get that where it needs to be. Make sure the timing's right. Okay, it needs to be right there. And we'll tighten that up. By the way, if you had offered me $1,000 if I could get that timing that close without actually setting it, I would have lost that bet. That was a freak accident. Well, kids, that's going to do it for this episode. When we come back, we will be doing some final assembly and final adjustments. You'll note I did not show cleaning bobbin case and bobbin case positioning bracket. I haven't done them yet. However, what I am going to do, because I've already done that video at least once, possibly twice, or maybe even more, I'm going to go ahead and I've got other videos of that. I'm going to edit those two videos together with a little, with a new introduction. And I'm going to make that as a supplemental. It'll be a video that will follow this in a day or so, where we'll go over how to put the how to clean those and get them done. In the interim, I will do these. I'm just not going to do them on camera, especially now tonight. It's getting late. A couple other things that need to be done on this yet. The bobbin winder obviously needs to get put back together, get cleaned and put back together again. And I haven't done anything with this goofy little upper thread tension assembly with the tiny, tiny discs that this one has. I'm not even sure if I'm going to use this one or not. I probably will, just to keep it authentic. Anyway, that's what I've got for this episode. Thank you so much for watching, and we will see you on the next one.